You're listening to The Bill Bennett Show. Bill Bennett
Show. Let's welcome Brian Kennedy and Joel Fargus to the show, gentlemen.
I want to do some foreign policy. I want to do some talk about America. But first, let's look abroad. Brian, I'll start with you. You're our foreign policy guy. Ukraine, what's going to happen and what should we do?
Well, I can tell you what we shouldn't do. Senator Wicker from Mississippi was on Fox News a couple days ago talking about sending troops to the border, preparing for every military option, including going to war, and even use the very inartful phrase that, you know, we don't take anything off the table. We reserve the right to use, you know, first strike nuclear weapons. Well, let me just tell you, that's a very irresponsible way to talk about any of these things. I can't figure out for the life of me why it's in the U.S. national interest to go to thermonuclear war over the Ukraine. The Ukraine was part of the Soviet Union. It's a place that is right next to Russia. During the Biden administration, the Russians took Crimea, which was part of Ukraine. It's in their backyard, and it's not in the national interest to go to war over the Ukraine. And if we're not going to go to war over Ukraine, then we ought not to talk that way about it. And there seems to be in Washington this weird, you know, obviously there's a military-industrial complex that still dominates much of the foreign policy discussion. And these people keep on angling for going to war somewhere, anywhere. And the place now is Ukraine, and it's completely irresponsible. We're not going to do it. We shouldn't do it. And we shouldn't invite Ukraine into NATO. Why would we do that?
They want to be part of NATO, and we don't like the Russians, and we like more buffers against the Russians.
Right.
They want to be free of Russia. That's a good thing, right?
Sure, but that's up to them, not us.
Right.
We're guardians of only our own, right? We may be friends of liberty everywhere, but we really are guardians only of our own. Let's say they join NATO and then Russia invades Ukraine. Are we going to war over Ukraine?
I don't think so. I want to go to war over Ukraine.
Right. Well, invite him into NATO. Let him be part of NATO, and then you're going to war over Ukraine. And that's not in the national interest.
Would you keep them out of NATO?
I would. Why would we have any more entangling alliances than we need, right? We ought to be worried about what's good for us. What's good for us is a strong, prosperous United States. We don't have one of those today. We have quite the opposite.
Well, what about, Joel, do you have a view on this?
Yeah. Over the last decade or more, Russia was sending their natural gas through pipeline through the Ukraine to serve Europe.
Right.
During that period of time, we've watched the Obama administration and now the Biden administration not only not support Ukraine, but allow Russia to build the Nord Stream 2 pipeline to allow them to dominate energy supplies to Europe. If we thought we wanted to protect the Ukraine, we would have started with what Russia has been doing for the last more than the last decade. So now in typical elected official process, now it's a crisis. Now it's chaos. So what do? We shoot. We shouldn't shoot when we've ignored the real problem, which is the ex-German chancellor being head of Russia's Nord Stream 2 pipeline company, dominating Europe, controlling Europe like they're doing now. And then all of a sudden, now we're going to talk about going to war. If we were going to go to war, we would have done this a decade ago.
Well, let me pick up on the pipeline, because it does seem to me, obviously, I think it was a mistake for President Biden to, you know, cut off the XL pipeline here and then give the go-ahead for the Nord Stream 2 pipeline there. But now Biden is saying to the Russians, this is certainly on the table, and we will cut off that pipeline. But now I question what I just said.
Can the Germans
aren't going to agree to that, are they?
The ex-German chancellor runs the pipeline company. They're not going to cut the pipeline off. That's nonsense.
Right. We don't have any leverage there.
We have zero leverage. It's over.
So that should have been done a long time ago.
So we messed that up. And if the policy was we want to protect and preserve liberty in Ukraine, that's what we would have done. We obviously didn't want to. So now we're going to go start a nuclear war over it.
All right, so they've manned 175,000 troops on the Ukrainian border. What's the right response? None of our business. Do what you will.
Open the XL pipeline. Start producing more domestic energy here in the country. That'll have a shot at Russia.
Brian, you're right. Bill, we all talked about this 12, 15 years ago. The easiest way to preclude Russia and people like them from waging these kinds of wars and these kinds of activities is to reduce by half or by two-thirds the cost of energy in the world. Then will have no more money to do this. And we increase our production and we reduce our costs. The only thing Russia has is oil and gas production. If the price were $30 a barrel instead of $70 or $80 a barrel, they couldn't do this. They can do this stuff now because they got a bunch of money. It's called economic warfare as opposed to nuclear warfare.
Isn't this also happening, though, because of perception about Biden, because of Afghanistan, perception of weakness in Biden? He's not going to do anything anyway.
But it is the perception, but it's also the fact. He not only is not going to do anything, he specifically tacitly authorized removal of sanctions to allow the completion of the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. Yeah, he did that 6 months ago, and now he's met with this crisis, and he wants to verbally change it, but it's not going to change. It's over.
But by the way, if Germany wants to tie their economic future to Russia, that's their business too.
Correct.
Right?
I mean,
in our own national interest, we can sell Germans, natural gas, liquefied natural gas, and we should be. If it's economically viable for us to do so and we benefit, we should be doing a lot of that. If they want to make their bed with Russia, what are we going to do to stop that?
I didn't understand it when Joel said earlier, if you want to fight back, I mean, first of all, the horse has left the barn because we already made that deal, one. But two, if you want to fight back, open up the XL pipeline.
Well, and the other thing, to Brian's point, Germany, not only if they, it's not even if they want to, of course they want to. Russia has been historically selling natural gas to Europe on short-term spot contracts. They've wanted for years to have long-term take-or-pay contracts to tie Europe to Russia. Angela Merkel came out 3-4 months ago and said, Russia has all the right in the world to do that. And the reason why Europe's paying so much for gas is because they have short-term contracts. And Europe needs to go and sign the long-term take-or-pay contracts. So it's not even if they want to, of course they want to. And, and Brian's right. If they want to do that, when they do it, it's their business. But then we're going to have then they're going to come to us some other time when Russia does something else. And it's just going to be, it's so predictable. It's just to reaffirm what Brian said, it's so darn predictable. Of course, we should not go to nuclear war over these issues.
Why did Biden give the okay on the pipeline? What good reason did he have?
Why did he give the okay? Well, every lobbyist, including the German ambassador to the United States, showed up in America and convinced virtually every single elected official in Congress that they need to let them do this. It's their business. It's their right. It's their sovereignty.
They showed up during Trump too, right?
Yeah, they did. And it didn't work during Trump, but it certainly worked with Biden.
Okay. So do we say or do nothing?
Well, let me tell you what we are doing, which I think is instructive for your listeners. While all this is going on and pipelines are moving oil and gas all over Europe and all over Asia, in the United States, we have every public company that we know of has something called ESG mandates, environmental social governance. And for those of you who've never read an ESG report, let me give you a brief description of what it says. It says, if you are developing something that uses natural gas that violates ESG standards because natural gas is a fossil fuel, it contributes to climate change, it will cause toxic health and environmental issues with people. Oil production may or may not include benzene, which causes cancer and leukemia. So almost every public company that gets an ESG report says under no circumstances should you ever develop something near an oil and gas pipeline or oil and gas production facility. You should not allow it to be used. As a matter of fact, do not build anything that allows natural gas to serve as a heating source, because electricity is the new wave and electricity will in the future be powered by green energy. And that's what we see in the United States pretty much every single day, every single week, every month. So while we are allowing, or not, should we go to war because somebody's moving, building a pipeline and moving oil and gas to dominate a continent while our own country is moving to stifle everything that we are doing and preclude anybody from financing anything because they'll be pilloried? So that's what's going on right now in the United States while this other stuff is going on in Europe and Ukraine.
Should we do anything?
We should do what Brian said. Produce oil, produce gas, reduce the price from $80 to $30. And all of our adversaries who are completely dependent on revenue from oil and gas production can no longer wage their anti-liberty wars.
That's advice against your own personal financial interest, is it not?
It absolutely is. It's completely against it, but it's for Americans.
I understand. No, and I know where your heart is.
And we're not going to do it anyway.
Yeah. And we're
right, 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 right.
I mean okay. we're not going to do the right thing because we would rather make America poor than do the right thing. Yeah, I mean, the other thing we could do and take more seriously. I mean, right now we're not a serious nation. The other thing we could do to show Russia is to strengthen our military and take seriously President Trump's Space Force, which would have an application toward missile defense to protect the United States. But when we talk about the use of nuclear weapons in Ukraine, I mean, to protect Ukraine or to go to war with Russia, that's not morally serious because is Russia not going to attack the United States? Of course they are. And do we have a national missile defense to stop that? No, we don't. So they know that it's all just a bluff and not a very serious bluff. It's absolutely meaningless.
Just asking, do we do anything over there? I mean, I understand pump oil and gas and natural gas here, develop, strengthen the military. Anything to Russia? Any message to Russia?
I want Brian to address this because he's the expert, but from a layman American's viewpoint, when you have issues like this, you start with what you can do. And what we can do are things in America. We can produce more goods here. We can produce energy here. We can provide reasonably priced housing here. We can employ our population here. We can do those things, and we don't need anybody's tacit approval.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I think Joel is absolutely right. Those are the things we can control, and those are the things we should do right now. Sending troops to that part of the world. I mean, we have troops there already, but increasing it or to posture ourselves in any way as if we're going to war over this is, as I say, not morally serious.
Short of that, I mean, there are things you can do short of that. You can send Javelin missiles to the Ukrainians.
Well, again, it's part of the question of whether or not we're serious about these things. And also, we have to understand what is our national interest here. If the Chinese make a treaty with Mexico. Let's say you have a Mexican government that becomes virulently anti-American, and the Chinese make a treaty with Mexico, and they start sending missiles to Mexico to put on our border. What are we going to do about that? Are we not going to go to war over that? Sure, we are.
Okay.
And so if we start arming Ukraine against Russia, is that an act of war? Is that our national interest, right?
And I think the question about how serious we are, again, Ukraine's a perfect example. Economically, we allowed Russia to basically bankrupt the Ukraine by moving a pipeline. Yep. And then now we're going to supposedly arm them. Even if we arm them, I don't think Russia believes we're going to sustain that and be serious with it. I don't think anybody believes that we would do that. It would be a temporary solution. There needs to be a very methodical, serious, something you don't pull out of, like Afghanistan, and say you're going to be there and say you're not going to be there. If you're going to do it, do it. But you can't just do it because there's a crisis.
Got it. All right. We've exhausted that. Thank you. Let's go to China and Taiwan. How similar? Involvement in Taiwan, defense of Taiwan. In what ways is this the same analysis? In what ways different? Obviously, we don't have the oil question there, natural gas question there.
Russia's much more economically vulnerable than China.
The thing about China is today it's sending all sorts of fighter aircraft over Taiwan in order to intimidate the Taiwanese and or prepare for war to take back Taiwan, which they claim as their own. The difference between Ukraine and Taiwan is that Taiwan provides to the United States about 90% of our semiconductors that we use in all of our, you know, cars, refrigerators, computers, etc. That is mission critical to the economy of the United States. And so the relationship we have between Taiwan and the United States goes far beyond just the Taiwan Relations Act, where we, you know, promise to aid them in their efforts to promote a democratic and free Taiwan. So we do have a clear, immediate economic interest in Taiwan. Now, it is going to be something that if, for instance, Taiwan was invaded by mainland China, communist China, the Taiwanese themselves may well end up having to destroy all those semiconductor factories because they couldn't let the Taiwanese need to use that as a weapon, that they need to send that signal to the PRC that they, you know, the jewel of that whole enterprise would be those semiconductor factories. Now they want, the Communist Party wants Taiwan because of the symbolism it has, but it also wants it for that economic, you know, the economic tool that it would have.
Why can't they do semiconductor factories?
Well, they can and they've tried, but it turns out these things are not that easy to produce.
Okay.
And we should be doing them here in the United States with breakneck speed.
The comparison between Russia and China, United States, we can produce energy here. We can't produce easily as quickly what Brian just said. And yet we should, because that's how you counteract these things.
So is that a reason then to respond to China with military force?
Well, look, again, we very much admire our friends on Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
We do not have a national missile defense. The Chinese, if we got into a conflict with China over Taiwan, I believe they will use nuclear weapons. We do not have a national missile defense to stop such nuclear weapons. And we're left with the, you know, existential problem, would you trade Los Angeles for Taipei? And the answer for most Americans is going to be no. That's crazy. Why would we do that? So talking tough is not an answer. Going to war quite often in this regard is not the answer. It's making sure that you yourself are strong and free. So what should we do? We should build semiconductor factories in this country with breakneck speed. Get serious about that. But going to, again, thermonuclear war over another country is a very suboptimal, to put it mildly, choice to make. We may have to do that in the case of Taiwan. That would be most unfortunate. If Taiwan were taken by the Chinese Communist Party on the mainland, we ourselves may have to end up destroying those semiconductor factories because we're not going to let them fall into the hands of the Chinese Communist Party. Now, that is war. Let us be clear. That's war. You want to avoid war if at all possible. That's the predicament we find ourselves in today, because we have been irresponsible as a nation for the past 30 years when it comes to communist China. And we're left with these very undesirable alternatives. We have the capacity to make these kind of factories. We have the capacity to build a national missile defense. Why aren't we doing that with the greatest possible speed? Because we're not serious. We're gonna fund transgenders in the military and surgeries for transgenders in the military. We're going to devote a lot of intellectual and financial resources to doing that rather than doing the serious things which are required for our national defense.
All right, let me just push you a little bit. We don't have the missile defense. We don't have the semiconductor factories. The Olympics end and China invades Taiwan. What do you do, President Kennedy?
Well,
unhappy choices, as you said, unhappy. But what do you do?
Look, I mean, this is the crisis point we find ourselves in. Are you going to trade Los Angeles for Taipei?
Okay, the answer is no. Okay. No, I don't do it.
I want to advise President Kennedy.
Okay.
And by the way, the advice would take about 60 seconds because he already knows it. Start building at with great haste everything that we need in this country. For the last 40, 50 years, we've been listening to economists tell us we need a globalized system with just-in-time inventory where you think everyone interrelates and then you all work together. No, what we need are redundant supplies and reserves. We have something in petroleum called the Strategic Petroleum Reserve that came out of the 1970s when our nation was at 20-some percent interest rates and gripped by oil shortages. So we created this thing thinking that this would be helpful. And the idea, while it sounds great, the Strategic Petroleum Reserve basically accounts for a third of a day of the world's demand.
Yeah.
That's what they call a reserve. And so there is no reserve. And we don't have many things in reserve, including now semiconductors and all the other important things that this country needs, including defense. Why would you not want a defense against offensive weapons?
Sure.
When President Reagan, your former boss, came up with this idea, he was made fun of.
Yeah.
And here we are today. Like, why would we ever need that? Well, here we are today. The entire world is looking at waging war in space. And yet we still have these conversations as to relying on others who obviously are not our friends, who want to hurt us, who want to dominate us, and we just allow it. So
right,
President Kennedy, I know if he were president, he would start the first hour in office encouraging our country to produce what we need here.
All right, but he's not. He's not. We have unhappy choices. We don't have the missile defense. We don't have the semiconductor. I don't know if anyone is pushing it in Congress. Is anybody good and smart doing this, like Senator Cotton or anyone else? Can answer that.
They have a lot of the right views, but look, we there's a lot we can do with China today. I mean, there's Chinese students in American universities.
Okay, right.
Send them home. They really like their students in our universities. They learn a lot. They're able to engage in a lot of espionage against the United States that way. Send them home. Stop all scientific exchanges and technology exchanges between the U.S. and China. The Chinese value that quite a bit.
It's not even an exchange. What it is a theft under the term of exchange.
Right. It's us giving them technology, and they demand it, and we give it to them. Look, here's another point about just how unserious we are.
Okay.
We have today allowed Chinese companies, about 5,000 of them, to come to U.S. capital markets and to have American investors invest in those companies.
Yeah.
That number today is $4 to $7 trillion of U.S. investors' money has gone to the PRC that way. $4 to $7 trillion. Everybody keeps talking about how China owns a trillion or so of U.S. Treasury bonds. And so, you know, we can't tell them what to do, which is ridiculous. $1 trillion out of $30 trillion now is not that big a deal, number one. But number two, if they wanted to sell that trillion off, the U.S. government would buy it themselves the way they've been buying Treasury bonds, right? But what does it mean when $4 to $7 trillion of U.S. investors' money is in the PRC?
Yeah.
The pressure from Wall Street on a U.S. president to not, you know, ruffle any feathers is just enormous.
Not one of those companies that American companies have invested in have to follow environmental social governance formats. Not one.
They don't even have to show audits. They're exempt from any normal auditing process. And
awful.
So
we're financing the PRC and all its ambitions.
Yes.
Right. I mean, this is, we have been so co-opted in this country. We're not living today in so many ways in a free country. We're living in an oligarchy where you have people on Wall Street and Silicon Valley. They have conspired to control the United States, both through our financing and big tech. They're the ones who are calling the shots. And today, Biden is reacting to that.
You know, Russia's not the only country that has oligarchs. We have a lot here. They are unelected people that wield tremendous power through economics.
Okay. Russia invades Ukraine. We're not going to war. China invades Taiwan, we're not trading Los Angeles for Taipei.
We've messed up terribly.
I don't think it's not completely dismal, because we know what we can start doing tomorrow morning.
Yeah, but there doesn't seem to be any will or intention or plan to do that here in Washington.
No political will. That's correct. No political will.
Look, the Chinese today engage in genocide against the Uyghurs and against the Falun Gong. They have the systemic rape and pillaging of their own population, literally systemic rape of the Uyghurs and the Falun Gong, the women of of those two populations. They engage in forced organ harvesting with those people. Forced organ harvesting. And what does the United States do? Nothing.
I mean, well, Secretary actually puts a camp in the territory of the Uyghurs to show them basketball.
Right. Yeah. Isn't that great? No, look, we're not serious now about our own national defense. We're not serious about China. And it is a scandal of epic proportions. I would invite anybody who's interested in both these things, by the way, and I personally think we should be boycotting the Olympics, not just a diplomatic boycott, but we shouldn't be going.
Joel, do you agree?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. You get canceled in this country if you vote for a particular candidate. So why in the world would you possibly travel all the way around the world to participate in with a country that does what Brian just described is unassailably true. It is a vicious, vicious group of people. Why would you do that? And here in this country, if you use the wrong pronouns and you're a professor, you get fired.
Yeah. Also, they've screwed up the CCP virus, COVID-19, it has screwed up the lives of Americans for the past 2 years.
Yep.
It has ruined things in this country. I'd like to ruin their Olympics.
Yeah.
What is the point here of these Olympics? To normalize, China in the eyes of the world. And in the eyes of the American people, you have smiley, happy Chinese people. They'll show you just what you want to see. And they'll act like we're all in this together, the Americans and the Chinese, and that we're just all one happy global family. And we're going to have an Olympics as if nothing else has happened. When in fact, China let that COVID-19 spread from Wuhan, China to the rest of the world, including the United States. And has done everything in their power to destroy our way of life. And we're going to go to the Olympics as if none of that matters. Are we not men anymore in this country who are willing to stand up for ourselves? We've been talking about Taiwan and Ukraine. How about standing up for America once in a while and the good of the American people? I don't see that coming out of Washington.
Did you see it with President Trump?
Absolutely. Which is why the Chinese declared a people's war on the United States in May of 2019. They signaled to their own population and the world that they were going to go to war with Trump because he was making them pay for all their malfeasance in the world, for stealing our intellectual property and engaging in bad trade deals. That's what Trump was doing. And so the Chinese waged a people's war against him. They spread, in my judgment, they spread COVID-19, and they helped corrupt through COVID-19. Our electoral process, because they wanted Trump gone. He took them seriously. And unfortunately, he didn't have enough people in Washington, in his own administration, who were on his side. The great failing history will record, I think, about the Trump administration is that he believed all the right things, but couldn't build an administration of people who likewise believed in these things.
Back to where we are. A lot of mess ups, not taking our own interests to heart, not doing what we need to do to protect our country, not doing what we need to do to develop resources like semiconductors and assets like that. Do we survive another 30 years?
Well, hell, I'm an optimist.
Why? You are?
Well, look,
like to ask the audience whether what they've heard.
I think the American people are fed up with what's going on.
I do, too.
I'm one of those people who think the last election was stolen, that people were overwhelmingly voting for Donald Trump. Not for the man, many for the man, but mostly because he was fighting for the American people. He was fighting for better trade deals with China. He was building a space force. He believed in complete energy independence and dominance. He wanted a rich, prosperous United States. I believe that you look at Joe Biden's polling numbers, he is completely underwater. People are completely unhappy with the direction of the country. I don't think we need to worry about 30 years. Let's worry about the next year. Because if in the next year, we can have free elections, I think we'll get a Republican Congress and a Republican Senate, and they will check the worst of Joe Biden. And I think if we have free and fair elections, we'll get a Republican president, whether it's Donald Trump or Ron DeSantis or Tom Cotton or whoever, Ted Cruz. I mean, there's a lot of folks in 2024. And I think we can still turn this around. But we need the right political leadership in Washington. And if we have that, we can fix this. And if we don't have that, then I think we're in deep, deep trouble.
Joel? I'm very optimistic. What I know about 30 years is I'm always wrong about 30 years. 1 and 2 year predictions are tough. 3 and 4 are harder. But I mean, in my businesses, I see American citizens doing what Brian just was describing, making very good choices for themselves. I mean, virtually all of the reasonably priced housing that's being sold in America today, single family homes with schools nearby and kids, are bought by minorities. They are living and pursuing freedom and the American dream. I see people abandoning cities because they're just unlivable. They're unsafe. We used to just say they were expensive. Now they're just unsafe and unlivable. There's an instinct in American citizens. There's an instinct that is so optimistic. And when someone goes and buys something that's the largest purchase they will ever make and has children to raise them, that in and of itself says that they have hope for the future and they admire it and they want to live it and they want to pass it on. And we spend a lot of time talking about our elected officials and how inept they are and how they do nothing, which is true. But we have 330 million American citizens. And most of those people, I believe, think like we're talking, want this, pursue it, and have an admiration for freedom and liberty on any topic.
I think Joel's absolutely right. I very much believe in the American people and their genius to get things right.
Will they get it right in time?
Well, you're the
chairman of the committee on the present danger, China. And I wouldn't be shocked if Chinese folks are listening to this because they track you. I know that. They're going to say before the American people wake up, we ought to really take them on. We ought to really get Los Angeles.
Well, yes. I think that is a worry, right? It shows you how important a presidential election is.
Yeah, sure does, doesn't it?
What the Chinese don't know is just how far the United States would go to resist their attempts to try to destroy us. There is a genius in the American people that they are not willing to tolerate being attacked. We're not willing to tolerate being attacked. We're here not very far from the anniversary of Pearl Harbor by the Japanese. And when that happened, as we know, people were literally hanging from the rafters at places where Americans would sign up for the military. And I think if the Chinese push us too far or attack us, you will see the might of the American people. Now, is it
the enlistment line isn't going to do much. I'm ready to fight in the trenches if they're raining down nuclear weapons on us.
Well, yes, but we can rain down nuclear weapons on them too.
Okay.
I think one of the most misunderstood thoughts of American citizens from people who are outside of America is what Brian just said. We don't seem to get much right when we should get it right. But there's been very few circumstances in the history of this country where we haven't made sure we defended our freedoms.
I was thought you were going to say, but we eventually get it right.
No, we defend our freedoms.
Okay. That's too strong a claim. We eventually get it right. We still don't get it right, but we defend our freedoms, right?
Yeah, that's as far as I'm willing to go with that statement.
Yeah, I understand. Okay, I understand.
By the way, Bill, in the great history of the world, countries like ours, you know, they've never existed. A free country like ours, rich and prosperous and free. You can see how the American people are the reason it's rich and prosperous and free. We have a group of elites running this country today. I called them oligarchs. There are other things too. But these people are corrupt. They don't believe in the goodness of America. And if the Chinese think they can get away with destroying America, guess what? They're going to try to do that, which is why Americans need to engage politically. They need to pray for their country. They need to do their jobs. And they need to live as good people, right?
But what made me worry and ask the question is, if they want to destroy America, given your quote optimistic assessments, the two of you, their best shot is now before this American capacity for self-renewal comes into being and is reflected in elections and resolve and so on.
I think we're living in a very dangerous time.
They have a very good shot right now, but things are not. They don't always go in a straight line. We have our own elected officials in this country that are making such absurdly outlandish, ridiculous choices that sometimes it makes the argument for those who love and want to defend liberty easier.
Okay, Brian, you've talked about the lack of missile defense. What about our offensive capability?
Well, it's deteriorated some. Over the years, deteriorated a lot. We've not tested the efficacy of our nuclear warhead since 1992. That's not ideal. We've not taken nuclear weapons as seriously as we should have. President Trump was doing everything in his power to get things back on track, but the military-industrial complex that was so influential in Washington, they don't seem to care about nuclear weapons or nuclear missile defense. They wanted to keep fighting wars in Iraq and Afghanistan and elsewhere, and that was their priority. And President Trump pushed the Space Force against all those, parts of Washington that could care less about it. Yep. We really do need to focus on both offense and defense, to your point, Bill. And we need to take these things seriously again. And unfortunately, this is one of those things that we just have not gotten right, and that we have to get right.
When anybody hears the term nuclear anything, it's a very emotionally charged term, and a lot of initial reaction because of propaganda has said, "Stay away, don't do it." Well, here we are. I don't want to keep going to energy, but here we are back 50 years after all the nuclear power plants were shut down. Yeah. Back to nuclear because they don't issue because they don't have CO2 emissions.
They're fossil fuels, right?
So this notion that because it says nuclear weapons that somehow you avoid it and abandon it, it's just too emotional. It's just propaganda.
Yes, if we were serious, we'd have more nuclear power plants. If we were serious about the environment, we'd have more nuclear power plants.
I think we are building more, aren't we, Joel?
We are starting to.
Now. Without the objection, without Jane Fonda, without demonstrations.
Isn't Germany getting rid of some of their nuclear power plants?
Yeah, and they're one of the biggest users of coal in Europe, and they lecture us on climate change, which is why we're not going to defend them.
Yeah, I got you. Back to where we started.
Right.
I want to leave it there. I want to thank you both very much. I want to just say I hope the audience, and I want to hear from the audience, has listened all the way through. To hear you two guys end up declaring your optimism about America, about the United States, because it was sounding pretty down for a while. Now you were giving us sober and in your, your best honest assessment of where we are. And I appreciate that. But I think for a lot of people, that's going to be a bucket of cold water in the face. Whoa, man, geez. So I think it's very good that you finished where you did. Good for me. I think good for the audience. Claude's pleased, I can tell. Thumbs up. And so I thank you, and we'll let you know what the audience says.
Yes, I'd like to hear what the audience says.
Yeah, great.
Claude, that pretty much does it for today's show. To catch up on previous episodes of the show, go to thebillbennettshow.com. And follow me on Twitter at William J. Bennett. You can like me on Facebook. Just search Bill Bennett. Feel free to email the show. We'd love to hear from you. It's BillBennettPodcast@gmail.com. Please share the podcast with your family and friends. We'll catch up next week.